Okay, good morning everyone and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Local Government and Communities Committee in 2017. Can I remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones, and as meeting papers are provided in digital format, tablets might be used by members during the meeting. So it's our appeal at the start of every meeting. If you see us using our laptops, that's what we're doing. Okay, we're looking at our papers. We haven't got a full house today. We've got apologies from Graham Simpson, but everyone else is in attendance. Thank you for your attendance. And we move to agenda item one, homelessness. In a moment I will introduce our panel of witnesses, but I wanted to give Alexander Stewart MSP the opportunity to put some comments on the record about a recent visit we've had in relation to a fact-finding session.
Thank you convener. On Monday my colleague Andy Whiteman and I went to Perth to meet with a number of representatives, and I really need to pay tribute to the Church's Action for the Homeless, which was the organisation we met, and their chief executive, Brian Cowie, who really gave us an hour and a half opportunity to meet with some of his senior staff and talk through their issues and their concerns. They were very honest. They were very frank about where they are. We then had the opportunity to see their charity shop, which they use. And then Andy went to Scone and I went to Burnham to meet some service users and individuals who had wished to have a conversation. And that was also very frank. Very fulfilling. So I think that event itself proved very, very beneficial as far as I'm concerned. I'm sure Andy felt the same, that they went the extra mile just to make sure that we were being accommodated in what they were trying to tell us are the issues that they have. And it was an excellent opportunity, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alexander, for putting that on the record, and thank you to yourself and Andy Whiteman for going along. We should at this stage, of course, put on the record our thanks to the Simon community in Glasgow for their frank and honest discussions, particularly in relation to women at risk of homelessness and rough sleeping in the city, and of course to Streetwork in Edinburgh, which allows me to move on seamlessly almost to introduce our witnesses today, which is Jan Williamson, Head of Services Streetwork. Jan, thank you very much for allowing our committee to come along and see the good work that you do in Edinburgh as well. We appreciate that. And thank you to the rest of our witnesses for coming along, which is Adam Lang, Head of Communications and Policy, Shelter Scotland; Tony Cain, Policy Manager, North Lanarkshire Council, Association of Local Authority Chief Executive Housing Officers; Lee Clark, Manager, Conflict Resolution Services; and Mark Kennedy, Manager, Homeless Prevention Services, Cyrenians. And Jan, you were at the bottom of my list. I almost was going to introduce you twice there, so I was. So thank you to all of you. There are no opening statements. We're going to move straight to questions. But before we take the first question, it's also worth putting on the record that whilst we'll explore themes today, and we've got another evidence session in a couple of weeks' time, the committee is looking for themes to explore in further detail at a later date, and almost certainly a call for evidence Scotland-wide to do a substantial and robust inquiry into homelessness in Scotland. So if you don't feel we're necessarily digging down enough in some of the themes and issues that you raised today, rest assured what we're hoping to do is allow you to, jointly with us in partnership, set an agenda for a future robust inquiry. So hopefully that's a reasonable rules of engagement for what we're hoping to do today, and we can work in partnership with you in relation to that. So now that we've put that on the record, can I ask our Deputy Convener, Elaine Smith, to open up questions?
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, everyone, and thanks for coming along to the committee today. I just want to sort of ask a general question at the beginning, and I notice in the submission from Shelter Scotland, Mr Lang, you're very clear that there's an urgent need for the Scottish Government to refocus on homelessness. So my first question, I suppose, would be, could, for the record, we put on the record some of the reasons why people become homeless? I just want to start with that, and maybe Mr. Lang could start.
Certainly, yeah. Statistically speaking, in terms of those that are recorded, the single biggest reason that's recorded for people becoming homeless in Scotland is relationship breakdown within the home. It's closely followed with a range of other issues which are sort of bundled with the same rough percentage rate, if you like. Arrears is a big problem, financial arrears, but it's relationship breakdown that is the dominant issue, which I think is something that, in terms of assumptions people might have about reasons why people become homeless, is not always the one that people might come to first.
Could I explore that slightly further?
Of course, yes.
In terms of that then, would that be more single male homeless, or would it be women fleeing violence? What would there be underlying statistics there?
There are underlying statistics from the Scottish Government. There's a certain limit to them. They don't go into a huge amount of detail, but I believe, and forgive me, I don't have the breakdown in front of me, but single male homelessness is a big part of the official homelessness figures, yeah.
Then if the rest of the panel want to comment on that?
I think I would go a little further. I mean, that is why individual households become homeless and sometimes present as homelessness, but I think the question is more interesting if it's why is it some households become homeless and most others do not, although the rate of homelessness is astonishingly high. When you look at the figures. And it's something about the choices and the routes to accommodation that the housing system offers. Some people have choices and options, and they have the capacity to exercise those options and stay in control of their journey, and others do not. And that's because of the way the housing system works and the extent to which it offers choice, supports choice, and allows folk to control that journey. So government policy is not going to end relationship breakdown. It's not going to end the moment when a young person decides to leave home. The issue is, does the system offer to all those individuals the degree of choice and the degree of control that they need in order to make the decisions they need and secure the housing that they actually want?
Is that an opportunity for other witnesses to make some general comments in response to our Deputy Convener's opening question, if anyone wants to come in? Jan?
I think you may see a difference if you looked at the reasons for females and males finding themselves homeless. Well, it would be relationship breakdown, the violence being more prevalent for females. Be a bigger underlying factor.
Okay. Lee Clark.
Certainly for 18 to 24-year-olds, it is relationship breakdown within the family.
Mark, don't feel obliged. You have to say something. We'd love you to comment.
There are actually one or two things I wanted to add there, and I think there are things that have become more evident in recent months and years. I think we're finding in homelessness prevention services that there are a lot more people in danger of homelessness because of recent welfare reforms, things like benefit caps, local housing allowance rates, where people could maintain a home beforehand. Suddenly they're finding themselves hundreds of pounds short of making their rent a month because they've had their benefits capped. I mean, I know that there were 800 families in Edinburgh affected by the recent reduction in the benefit cap. And also a big underlying issue we come into contact with a lot are people who, in a broad sense, you could say suffer from mental health or emotional issues, which make it very, very difficult for them to administer and maintain the home they have or to sustain a tenancy when they actually get one. And we find that's quite a large cause of homelessness.
So thanks, Convener. Part of that then seems to be that there's an issue with linking poverty and homelessness. But also it was something Matt Kennedy said about prevention of homelessness. So would you think that if we were to be doing an inquiry, we might want to look more closely at how prevention services work and how maybe they could work better to try and stop homelessness?
I might get Mr Kennedy first, and then I'll take you after Adam Lang, because Mr Kennedy was referenced in the question there.
Yes, I think there's certainly an issue around there around how prevention services work and are funded. And I mean, we were discussing this before we come in, and there was a general feeling that the nature of the funding that we receive, for example, to provide prevention services in the city of Edinburgh, has stipulations attached to it about the amount of time that we can support people for example. So for me, a housing crisis is not something that happens one day and can be sorted 6 months later. There are often ongoing issues there that make it very, very difficult to work with someone in a short period and resolve those issues. So there needs to be a recognition that there are perhaps individuals who are threatened with homelessness or become homeless who have longer-term support needs, which don't quite reach the threshold for statutory services. And when I say statutory services, I mean things like social work, but would find it very difficult to maintain a home over a longer period of time without some sort of support. So there needs to be a sort of a support that's more open-ended, if you like.
Mr. Lang.
Convener. I would very much welcome any further investigation or look into issues of prevention. And I think worth noting, as is highlighted in some of the submissions for today and previous reports, that the previous Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee, I believe, did in its legacy report highlight, on the back of the Scottish Housing Regulator's inquiry in 2014 into housing options, that housing options and general work towards homelessness prevention should be and would be a worthwhile area to examine further. And I would definitely support that. And if I may just briefly build on that to say that housing options is a very welcome approach to engaging early with people who are at risk of homelessness. But I think there's much more we need to understand and unpick about how that's being delivered across the 32 local authorities, about the standardisation of recording of housing options approaches, because I think there is some concern that the figures on homelessness and housing options approaches, when you combine those people who apply as homeless and those people from the housing options figures that have homelessness identified as an outcome, the total number is up around 50,000, I think, just higher than 50,000 annually, which goes in the face somewhat of the recorded decline on the official homelessness statistics. Because I think if you look at the two sets together, you'd see that the number of people at risk of homelessness or in housing need has remained fairly high.
Okay. Thanks, Convener. I think we've moved down to the area that you were quite keen to explore.
I'm happy to take on that back now if you want. It's up to yourself. We don't rehearse this, I promise you. We were very interested in the housing options model. Now, at face value, and actually in my own constituency experience, sometimes it can work very well. It can sometimes have vulnerable constituents look at other options perhaps they hadn't considered before on a one-to-one basis and build up a relationship, but not always so. So I'm certainly keen to hear what bits of housing options have been starting to work well, because if what Mr. Lang's saying about the figures is accurate, I would want to know how many of those individuals going through housing options are getting a better service than they would have done had they went through the alternative homelessness route, or is it making any difference at all? So we're keen as a committee, I think, to grasp what's really happening with housing options. Is the quality of experience for vulnerable constituents any better under housing options? Where is it working well? Can we get some examples of that? And how should we monitor this as a committee going forward, I suppose? Because Mr. Lang's point was perhaps, yes, there might be some good parts to it, but we're not really grasping precisely what's happening with housing options just now. So what's the... I might take you last on that, Mr. Lang, if you want, because I know you've spoken about it before, and you'll have more to say on that. What are other witnesses... What's your feeling around the housing options model? Have you any experience of it? Mr. Kennedy?
I feel that the housing options approach has, I think it's created a system that's very, very transparent, and in terms of people who are using it, where it works as it should, it works very, very well because people know what they can expect from it. In my experience working in the City of Edinburgh, I would say that it's not always, I think, going back to what Adam said earlier, it's not always the reality of the service people receive when they present themselves at the council or they make an approach to a statutory agency is not consistent. And I think that over the last, I think since 2012, when the priority need test was eventually gotten rid of, there's maybe been a bit of a lag in terms of the mindset of people who are administering the housing options approach in terms of how they view their job or how they're treating the people that walk into who have housing issues. And I think the implementation has been quite patchy, I think, across local authority areas.
Lee Clark, did you want to add anything to that?
One of the main things is the training as well. So it's the training and being consistent on different local authorities of that training and how that's rolled out.
That's really helpful as well. again, don't feel the need to answer other witnesses, but Tony Cain, I think you were indicating you wanted
to. Absolutely. I think it is unquestionably the case that Housing Options is being operated differently in different authorities, and you see that both in the regulator's report from a couple of years ago and in the statistics that were recently published by the Scottish Government. It is operating differently across the country. What I think is most important about Housing Options is it's a process which is intended to focus on the individual. So what is it you need? What are your particular unique circumstances? How do we act to assist you in resolving your homelessness is the ethos behind Housing Options. That is absolutely the antithesis of what the legislation says. And as I said in my evidence, this is 40-year-old law. The homelessness legislation was passed in 1977. People tend to assume it's not that old, but it is. And it's written in a way which is very clear that the process is done to applicants. There's no control in there. If a local authority has reason to believe somebody who's come to them for housing or for housing assistance might be homeless, then they are required to carry out an assessment whether or not that individual wants that assessment done, whether that's their choice or the particular route, or whether they've understood what their outcomes are. The law just says you go and do it to them. And then tell them what you're going to do for them. And I think, so the importance of Housing Options is the beginnings of a change in culture around the way we respond, the way local authorities are responding to the people that are approaching them for assistance. And I think that's very important, but we've got a long way to go on that.
It might be quite helpful, Adam Lang, I'll take you now if that's okay, but see we've had the chance to speak elsewhere in relation to Housing Options, so some getting some of this on the record would be really, really helpful. I suppose the committee would be quite keen to know really what is the substantial difference, if it works well, between Housing Options and traditional homelessness route. And Tony Cain was starting to allude to some of that, for what that would look like if it works well. So anything else you can add to better steer the committee and further scrutinising this would be very helpful.
So I suppose I probably won't do justice to this, but in its simplest form, Housing Options is about preventing people from becoming homeless. It's about engaging earlier, and as its name suggests, informing people about their housing options at an earlier stage, a more preventative stage, before they reach that, potentially that crisis point. And I think inherent in that is the challenge of looking at it solely from a statistical point of view, because by the nature of good prevention work, you shouldn't end up recording the same type of outcomes in the absence of good prevention work, if that makes sense. So the difference being that if somebody is making a traditional homelessness application, they go to their local authority, apply as homeless, and are either assessed or as unintentionally homeless or not, and they go through the traditional route of usually into temporary accommodation on the route to permanent settled accommodation, in theory. And Housing Options is about engaging with people earlier, where possible, to prevent them potentially ever getting to that point. So that's it, in its crudest sense, I suppose, is the principle behind Housing Options. And I would just echo that we're fully supportive of Housing Options. I think it's a very positive thing. The challenge, though, is that there was, at the time Housing Options was rolled out, it was not rolled out with formal guidance on how to implement Housing Options. That came a couple of years later, and has only relatively recently been rolled out, and it's not statutory guidance, which allows for a certain element of, and this has been highlighted by the Scottish Housing Regulator, different ways of interpreting how to do Housing Options, and different local authorities, as has been touched upon, different local authorities with different resources, with different structures, with different local priorities, have implemented it in different ways. So looking at it in a purely statistical, we've now had, I believe, 2 years of returns from Housing Options data. Looking at them, it tells you something, but I don't think it tells you the full picture about the implementation of Housing Options. I think that's why I very much welcome the fact that this committee have been going out to hear from frontline service providers about the reality on the ground, because statistics and reporting can only tell you so much. And I think from Shelter Scotland's point of view, we would like to see that guidance, what impact the rollout of that guidance now has in terms of the official statistics on Housing Options, the Prevent One statistics, what we start to understand. But I think there are some concerns about, just as an example, does Housing Options recording go far enough in telling us about the outcomes that people achieve? Because I believe that in the current setup, homelessness is recorded as an outcome in Housing Options. And it's about, actually, we need to know more than that. We need to know about, and then what? And then did that person get the support they need to go into permanent settled accommodation? Did they get temp? How long did they spend? We need to know more. and we've only had a couple of years of data coming back on housing options.
That's very helpful. My apologies, I'm probably asking a question that I should know the answer to, and I don't. I'm sure in my constituency it might be the local housing association that might do a housing options. Who does the housing options with the tenant? In my situation, it might be a tenant who's sofa surfing, staying with a relative. We contact a housing association who says, well, the Glasgow doesn't have council housing stock, contact a housing association who will say, we'll do a housing options appraisal. So it's not just local authorities that does it, it can be the housing association movement that does it as well. And during that appraisal, do they have the option of recommending additional support for individuals who might struggle to maintain a tenancy? So if someone is sofa surfing and someone's, you know, and someone's couch, and tenancies are broken down before, and they go through a housing options route, as part of that, would that housing options look at saying, well, there should be a support wraparound support mechanism here to help this person sustain a tenancy? Does that happen as part of that conversation, or could it happen? Anyone get any information, Mr. Kennedy?
In theory, anyone who is in danger of becoming homeless should be offered support to help prevent them becoming homeless. So within the guidelines, it does say that local authorities or whoever is carrying out that homeless assessment should be making an offer of support. We find that in most, you're relying on the knowledge of the person who carries out the assessment, how busy they are, how that's implemented. In a lot of cases, people are offered support. In some cases, they're not. Yeah. Okay. So it's not, while it is part of the regulation, it's not universally applied.
That's it. I'll take you all in, absolutely. Jan Williamson, do you want to?
I agree. In theory, yes, they can refer for support, but we broke down our referrals for people. So Streetwork supports people with multiple complex needs. And we receive very few referrals from the housing options team in Edinburgh.
That's interesting. Lee Clark?
Yeah, going back again to an earlier point, and definitely what Mark was saying, it's about the training and the knowledge and the skill of the housing officer that's carrying out that assessment, and their knowledge and understanding of what's available and what that presenting need is from that person.
The housing officer doesn't know there's additional options for support there, they may not do that as part of the assessment. That's really helpful to know. Yep. Tony Cain, do you want to add?
I think in part this in part shows up the distinction between the statutory basis for homelessness services and the entirely discretionary policy framework around housing options. The legislation requires that where a local authority determines somebody is homeless and not intentionally so, that they should carry out a support needs assessment. So that should be done, and that's part of the legislation. That's not part of the housing options process, although a good housing options process will also include a conversation about what are your support needs, what particular help do you need to assist you in dealing with this issue. So there is a distinction very clearly around support. I mean, the other important point to make is that the range of support services that are available is, particularly in some areas, wholly inadequate. And I would say very clearly, mental health responses, the response from mental health teams, community mental health teams, is almost completely inadequate when it comes to meeting the needs of the most disadvantaged homeless folk, those who are long-term in the system. They do not get a response. And this is not just the way services are organised. In my view, this is the way clinical practice works. It's arranged around people turning up for interviews, people turning up for appointments, which is absolutely not the way in which you need to deliver services to people who are chaotic, who've got drug and alcohol-related problems, who may be in and out of the community justice system. It's just the mental health services are one of the major areas of failure around meeting the needs of this more chaotic client group. But they're an important part of the client group. They're not all of it by any measure of means, and homelessness has a fairly broad spread. One of the statistics, just to reemphasise the point in my submission, our estimation is that 1 in 8 household moves in Scotland, 1 in 8, 12%, involves some element of homelessness. Now, that's an astonishing statistic about the number of people who find themselves needing to move, who struggle to complete that move under their own steam. So absolutely right to focus on the most disadvantaged of the homelessness client group and the failings in the services available to them. But let's not imagine that is all about homelessness. There are many people on otherwise perfectly satisfactory incomes in work who struggle in the current system to meet their housing needs.
I'm going to discipline myself not to ask lots of follow-up questions, Mr. Cain, in relation to that. You're giving lots of food for thought to explore further. Adam Lang, do you want to add anything to that?
I would just build a little bit on what's said there, that I don't have anything to add in terms of the frontline expertise on who delivers housing options, but I think it's an important point to make that housing options should not be mistaken for or not confused with a genuine strategic approach to homelessness prevention. It is a welcome approach to engaging early with people who might be at risk and a range of housing issues, but it is not a whole system response to homelessness. And I think that builds on what Tony's saying and what others have been saying. And I would just add, in particular, that is true for those people who have multiple complex needs or multiple exclusion homelessness. And I think it's important that the conversation on homelessness in Scotland isn't solely dominated by housing options. It's a welcome approach to engaging with people. There are some challenges which we've highlighted, but it is not the same as a strategic response to homelessness.
I can reassure you, whilst I know I've got a couple of supplementaries from members in relation to housing options, there's much more areas we want to focus on as a committee as the questions roll out. Elaine Smith, did you want to have a supplementary?
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, specifically to Mr. Cain, if I may. Actually, it was a wee bit beyond housing options. It was just to ask Mr. Cain whether or not you think that we, as a committee, should look at the fact that the local authorities have the statutory duty towards homeless persons, but in areas where there's been, for instance, stock transfer, then that might cause issues. And I just wonder if you think that's an area that needs further explored.
Absolutely, and I think we said this quite clearly in our submission. Part of the homeless legislation as it was written in 1977 was specifically to transfer statutory responsibility from social work to housing, and in doing so to open up housing allocation systems. That's what the 77 Act was about. That's 40 years ago. The world has moved on. There's no question that statutory obligations around homelessness need to be more widely cast. But I think, I would go further and say we need to review all our housing and related legislation and satisfy ourselves that the whole system is properly directed at preventing homelessness and creating choices and routes into housing across the population. It's similar to the way we would deal with issues around human rights. Treating people with dignity and respect is an essential for a civilised society. We write our human rights legislation into every aspect of all our legislation. Having a roof over your head is essential for life, and yet we compartmentalise all the statutory duties around ensuring that remains the case. We need to look at the whole system again.
And Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Following on from the comments you've made, the whole idea of individuals who have, as you've indicated, complex needs. They may be mental health problems, they may have drug and alcohol dependency, but also numeracy and literacy and the way they're communicated to by the authority, the housing officer, how that's managed can sometimes put them into a fear, a panic, a crisis situation because they're not able to manage that process. And I'd like to get some of your experiences of how that works, because that you could have someone who's going through the journey, who's been identified, who's gone into temporary and is then looking for. And in amongst all of that, you then find that the chain gets broken because something falls down. They don't manage to get an appointment on time. They don't manage to get what the letter's telling them to do. They don't understand what's meant to the process. And I think that's quite important, because that's what we identified when we went out, that the chain was getting broken on a number of occasions before we got to the end result. And people then were coming back through the system and re-engaging and reassessing. So I think that's quite important, because that was not my impression before I went out and found out more information.
Clark.
Often there will be one presenting need, but when you build that relationship and get to know someone, you then realise that there's more presenting need, need that appears later on, for sure. And it's very difficult to build a relationship with a one-hour housing options interview. So potentially that is why that happens such a high percentage of time, because you cannot begin to understand complex need in a one-hour interview.
To comment, Adam Lang.
Sorry, thank you, Convener. I would support that point. Last summer we had a PhD volunteer work with us who did a fantastic bit of research for us, looking at the the East Housing Options Hub in Scotland, in particular around experiences from practitioners and commissioners of services and the client group around who had multiple and complex needs. And he was trying to understand the issues that those individuals face engaging with services and how the services are commissioned. And there was a range of findings, which I won't do justice to here, but the key takeaway point was that we're not currently commissioning services to be delivered in a way that supports that group who are most vulnerable. Exactly the point that was made, you can't get a full sense of somebody in an hour. These people need sustained engagement with a constant point of contact over a prolonged period of time to not just help them through the paperwork, but to help them through into secure accommodation at the other end, or whatever the issue is, and to address your points, to try and prevent exactly that issue of them going back into the system or falling out at some point once that support's removed, because you are talking about people who, by the very nature, have multiple issues that they need help with.
Yeah, a lot that we help people to get into emergency accommodation and have to follow that up with going along to the local authority and going through a full assessment, and quite a substantial percentage don't make it along, and despite our efforts to try and help them get there, they struggle with that. And we've invited the local authority for years to come and be at our centre, because if we can't get people to you, they're coming to us. Could we think about how we locate our services? But there's challenges around the technology and being able to do that, so we haven't got there yet. But we would continue to advocate that for people with multiple complex needs, it's really difficult for them to keep appointment times, and so they end up churning through a system, just repeatedly going into emergency accommodation placements and never moving on from there.
Also points out the point Mr. Lang was making about housing options has to be within a wider strategy, and there's more to it, and we'll maybe move on now to the next line of questioning. Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to focus a little bit more on those folk with complex needs. I hear what Tony Ken says about that's not the whole picture, but if we can just talk about that for a little bit longer. The evidence we've received and what we've seen on our visits, and thanks to Streetworks for having us there, is that it would seem that the housing support needs of people with complex needs are not being met all the time. And the other thing I was quite shocked to hear was a worker told me of a young man who she was told he was too high need for any of the supported accommodation options that were available. So I would like to hear what types of supported accommodation you think work well, if there are. I'm assuming there are some out there. You know, what do we need to have available for folk like that?
Have good examples of supported accommodation that works relatively well for people in comparison to temporary accommodation, bed and breakfast style. And it's about the understanding of the needs of the people by the people who work there, and their ability to maybe be a little bit more flexible and tolerant than a bed and breakfast where you have to be in by 10 o'clock at night and that's it. And the relationships that they can build with staff who are there is a big factor in helping them to people who understand their needs and who will support them, build a relationship with them over time and help them to address their needs. So we have some in Edinburgh, but there isn't enough. And so bed and breakfast accommodation is used for the majority of our people.
So we are nodding our head there. Do you want to add anything?
Yeah, that is the real root of the problem. Yes, there is great models, great examples. There is definitely not enough. And the support available to understand and work with someone on that journey isn't available either. So that is very low.
Ruth, do you want to? Oh, sorry, Jan, yes.
Not one size fits all. So you'd have to have a range of options. I went to visit St Mungo's in London, and they had a a hotel-style model that worked really well. And it was just, they listened to people and what worked for people. They saw that people were actually booking them in themselves into this one particular bed and breakfast that was working well. And so they copied that model. So they had a range of different options for people.
We clarify, yes.
It's definitely the key is relationships and the way that you build that relationship and how that's maintained and that understanding.
Yeah, I mean, I think I would go, if you'll forgive me, a little bit further around where we are with temporary accommodation. I think it is the case that Edinburgh, Glasgow, Dundee, Aberdeen, the bigger cities, have the opportunity to develop a wider range and sometimes quite sophisticated and quite specialist supported and temporary accommodation. Glasgow can afford to offer and deliver a women-only hostel, for example. But outside the big cities, what you tend to find is that homeless temporary accommodation, the word hostel is used, generally they're referring to a block of flats, all of which is used for temporary accommodation. They're not necessarily shared facilities in the way you would understand a hostel, but they are used for the whole range of clients coming through the door. So you will find some quite difficult social mixes within this accommodation. High-risk offenders, young vulnerable adults, individuals with offending backgrounds, individuals with drug and alcohol-related issues, people with mental health problems, people with learning disabilities, all using the same front door and the same block. And I don't think we are as well-sighted as we should be on the risks around that social environment and paying enough attention to ensuring that those elements of the service we're offering are actually safe. There's all sorts of issues that could arise in those circumstances, and I don't think we're well sighted on them, even though we've improved the physical quality of accommodation. So big cities, I think, have done a great deal, but it's much more difficult outside those cities where scale is an issue. And that comes down to revenue funding. And you'll forgive me, this is some of the evidence that I gave to this committee around the budget. There are real challenges around revenue funding of these services within local government, as there are in IJBs, as there are in some of the health services that we desperately need.
So you're absolutely fine to put that on the record. That's not a problem. Ruth, do you want to explore that?
Just moving on a bit, and I suppose it kind of ties in, it's about the health needs of folk who are using services. And we heard there from you that appointments for keeping any sort of appointment can be challenging, and I just wonder, are there opportunities around health and social care integration for different models that can better support homeless people and improve their health?
There are two areas that we need to pay particular attention to. We will get later on this year the results of a data matching exercise that the Scottish Government has been in the process of leading, which brings together health data and homelessness data. And what it will show, we already know, is that the health of long-term homeless households and the life expectancy of long-term households is disastrous compared to the main. In terms of life expectancy, worse, substantially worse than the most deprived geographical population has gone. 47 is the life expectancy of a male in the long-term homeless system. It's appalling. And the two areas of health service that let them down most is GP services, where many homeless folk find real difficulties getting access to GPs. And no disrespect to the deep-end GPs like the Hunter Street Practice in Glasgow, who focus and specialise very much on delivering services to homeless folk. But outside these areas, GP services are very, very difficult to access very often. And homeless folk very often use A&E as their GP, with all that that implies in terms of the expense, the cost, and the inappropriateness of that behaviour or that approach. And the other issue is around mental health, where mental health services, as I've already said, are just not achieving the outcomes that we need. There are significant issues of self-harm, significant issues of attempted suicide and suicide in this population. It feeds into their life expectancy. And there's a conversation that needs to be had, but it takes me back to my earlier point about, and the point that was raised earlier on, about the scope of the homelessness legislation and where the obligations lie. If they only lie on housing services or local authorities, and that means housing services, then it's no great surprise that other services are not stepping up. The GP contract is currently being renegotiated. You will be aware of that. I have raised questions about whether or not those changes to that contract can be used to reinforce the need for GPs to deliver services more flexibly to homeless people. And the response has essentially been a big shortage of GPs. The workload's too high already. We probably can't deal with it in this contract. I'm not entirely convinced that's enough.
Adam Lang, yes.
I just to add a couple of points to that, I think there is a significant role that primary healthcare can play in supporting early intervention and provision of advice and support and signposting to specialist support where appropriate to prevent homelessness. And I think that echoes the point Tony's making across the board. And I think I would also add that we've also, through the services we provide across the country, we've also had in several instances been made aware of people who are essentially using accident and emergency as a form of overnight B&B, people who are at risk, very vulnerable people, people with high level of needs, because they know that they can get a roof over their head that way when other systems have failed them, or when they've been they've fallen through the gaps of other forms of support.
Take Mark Kennedy.
Yeah. Say that if we kind of move a little bit away from people with complex needs, what we've found working in Edinburgh is that we were speaking earlier about what are people are signposted for support through the housing options system and how that generally doesn't happen. Jan had said that very few of her referrals come in that way. And what we've found is we get an awful lot of people referred to us through various NHS services, but that has relied on us as an organisation going out and forming relationships with those services and making them aware of what's available to people. Now, within the sort of the whole health and social care integration process, or within the creation of locality hubs, which is happening in Edinburgh at the moment, there's got to be some scope for ensuring that health services, homelessness services, other social supports work more closely together in a more integrated way to ensure that when people are about to fall into housing crisis or suffering a housing crisis, that it's identified, because it is often the health professionals that will identify it first. We found, for example, health visitors and district nurses are a really good source of referrals for us, because they're getting into people's homes, they're speaking to them, they're finding out where people have crises in other areas, where they're financially stretched, where they're about to lose their home, and they can refer to us. But that has depended on us going out and forging those relationships. There isn't any sort of an infrastructure there that can direct those people to us.
Very much. Just wanted to double check, Lee Clark, I will take you in, but Ruth, there's been a lot of responses there. You might want to, we'll take you in next, Ruth, do you want to follow up on any of that?
No, I'm quite happy to just hear
yes,
from them.
Yes, Lee, yes.
I was going to say, going back to your question, there is real opportunity in the integration of health and social care if we get it right. And I think one of the key areas there is to look at the flexibility of their approach in how people can access their service, and the lowering potentially of thresholds that they have for referrals into different services there.
Mr. Lang.
Thank you. Could I just add that on that point, whilst I absolutely agree there is real opportunity, there is also a challenge about the health and social care integration agenda, because it goes hand in hand with other public service reforms that are either ongoing or forthcoming. We have a dozen or so health boards, we have 32 local authorities, we have 32 health and social care integration joint boards, we have one police service, we've got 15 prisons. We have a very mismatched landscape of public service delivery, if you like, in Scotland. And I would, the part of the rationale why Shelter Scotland and others have been calling for a new strategic approach to homelessness is that as all these things go through in an era of less and less funding available for all these services, they're going to focus down on those things that are their strategic obligations or their statutory duties that they have to deliver. And there is a real risk that in all that churning and all that mix, the issue of homeless, providing people who are at risk of homelessness with the support they need and the early intervention they need, gets lost in the mix. So I don't disagree at all. There is a real opportunity, but that has to be balanced against the challenge of making sure that homelessness is a strategic priority in this time of quite significant public sector reform.
Okay. Thank you. Lee
Clark, yes. I totally agree with that, and that's where that threshold of referral route needs to be really clear on the flexibility of the approach that they bring to the health and social care integration.
Okay. Do you want to add anything? That was really helpful. Can I just check something? Because I thought your line of questioning was absolutely spot on, Ruth, in terms of health and social care integration. When we were at the Glasgow visit with the Simon community, they were saying they'd started a pilot project with Glasgow Homeless Services where a couple of the homeless casework team were going to be embedded with the Simon community, which I suspect in monetary terms will mean money saved, because you're much more likely to get a better outcome for vulnerable people with multiple and complex needs as you build up that relationship. So I hate to use the expression service redesign, because that sounds really massive, whole systems change. But is there lots of overlapping opportunities for more of that work, whether it's mental health workers being embedded with homeless teams? And Mr. Cain mentioned resource issues. And yes, there may be the need for additional resources, but are we also maybe not using current resources as effectively as we could be as well?
I think that's absolutely the case. And I mean, the best example to give would be around housing homelessness and reoffending. Something like a third of everybody leaving prison, whether that's remand or on sentence, is pretty much discharged straight to the nearest homeless service. That's what they do. About a third of them leaving prison go straight there. Losing your home, research published by the Scottish Government last year demonstrated very clearly that losing your home, struggling to get a home, is a substantial issue in reoffending. And reoffending costs this country £3 billion a year. That's the figure that the Housing Minister himself was talking about at the recent Homeless Prevention Strategy Group that I attended in this building. £3 billion a year is the cost of reoffending, which is in fact the whole five-year sum of the Scottish Government's commitment to affordable housing. That's the scale of the savings and the improvements that can be achieved if you can get the housing element of community justice processes and discharge from prison right, so that folk aren't being discharged into homelessness and so that they get the kind of support to divert them from the risk of reoffending. So there's huge opportunity to use the resources we have better.
Is the line doing to add anything?
I couldn't agree more strongly with that. There's the prison population in Scotland is roughly just under 8,000 annually, but there are about 20,000 releases each year from prisons in Scotland. And as Tony was saying, around a third of them don't have a home to go to on release. And there is still the issue of, when you're making a homelessness assessment at a local authority level, the issue of local connection. And there needs to be the ability for greater discretion in these cases for people coming out of care situations, prisons and others. And we also know that ex-offenders are overrepresented in homelessness statistics, and around a third of the third, if you like, who are released without a home to go on to reoffend because they know that the prison institution is a roof over their head in part.
Thank you, Ailey. I'll see Lee Clark first. Yes.
Going back to what you said, having different services cited together, so potentially mental health services cited within the housing homelessness options team, makes a huge difference on the way that they can achieve greater outcome. So that definitely goes back to that integration and how we do that.
Question we should be asking more widely when we do more of this. Mr. Cain,
just want to say on the issue of discharge from prison, there is an active, we're not just sitting back and ignoring that and pointing at the prison stuff. There is an active conversation going on at the moment between Alacho, Solace, the chief executives in local authorities, prison service and shelter, in fact, around how we can better work together to use our resources to reduce that number and to provide a better option service in the prison. So we are, you know, there's a very, very focused piece of work that's been going on for the last year or so around that. We're cited on it, but it is a huge challenge.
That's helpful. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, convener. Thanks all for coming in. This is extremely helpful. I want to talk about the relationship between the statutory services and the third sector in a minute. But first, do you have any comment on the Housing First model and how valuable that is? We've had some anecdotal evidence that people are being put into getting housing too quickly, they can't cope, and they're out again, but the statutory, the council feels that that's their obligation to do that.
So you were all looking at each other, Mark, and I caught your eye first, Mr. Kennedy.
In terms of people getting accommodation that they're perhaps not ready for, I think I'd refer to the earlier point about flexibility. There needs to be more flexibility in the support that's there for people. If I give our own example, we at the moment are limited to a 6-month period where we can work with people. If you're working with someone who has quite complex needs, they get allocated a tenancy 2 or 3 weeks in, that funding ends, then there's a very, very good chance that's going to break down. I think the Housing First model is for a lot of people a very good route to take, but it's very, very important that there's a consistency of support to ensure that people settle in to that to that tenancy, utilise it properly, make the links they need to make in the local community to make that work for them, get everything set up in a way that, that ensures that the tenancy is going to work for them, and where necessary, continue periodically to help people to sustain that housing situation, because as we've said earlier, there are people who will need ongoing help to sustain that situation.
Yeah, we would support bringing in Housing First in Scotland. The research worldwide shows it as an effective model with high success rates for people who experience multiple exclusion homelessness. But you have to stay true to the model. So yes, you have to offer support, but people don't have to take that support to keep the tenancy. And so I think it's an option that we should be exploring in Scotland.
Okay, Mr. Lang?
I would agree with that. I think ideologically, the Housing First model is a system geared more around a housing system rather than a homelessness system. And I think ideologically that's an important distinction and one that shifts the provision of support. But I think there's a couple of things and I would agree that yes, all the evidence internationally and from pilot cases definitely backs up that it is a valid and worthwhile approach. But it does, I would just echo the point, it does need to be embraced fully and not tokenistically. It needs to have both the flexibility of the support and crucially, and I think this is the challenge we would have at the moment with this in Scotland, it needs to have the options of different housing stock, greater supply of housing stock, social rented supply. We're currently way off where we need to be in terms of the percentage share of the housing stock that is available for social rent and the not just the targets for supply. And I think you need that in place to have an effective Housing First model, because you need flexibility and you need options, and those are two challenges we have at the moment.
Mr. Cain?
I would echo that. The way, particularly in local government, that we conceive settled accommodation is too narrow. I mean, I'm caricaturing, but essentially there is temporary accommodation and then there is a council flat or house, and that in the housing world in local government is how outcomes are seen. And we need to offer something much more flexible around what settled accommodation is, how it works, and the extent to which it requires individuals to manage that accommodation actively, particularly individuals who are requiring high levels of support and who are building up to taking more control over their life and coming out of a chaotic period. But I think you also have to acknowledge that there are risks associated with Housing First if it is conceived of a model which takes somebody who is highly chaotic and struggling to manage their life and struggling to manage offending, struggling to manage drug and alcohol issues, and then simply place them in a flat in a mainstream community and then expect that support services around them will prevent and avoid any difficulties arising. You need to acknowledge that communities themselves can be extremely concerned about individuals like that appearing in the flats next to them, extremely worried about the extent to which support will actually be available, and extremely angry when that support isn't available and those behaviours become very destructive of their lives. And I suspect as MSPs you've all had constituency cases where a homeless person has been placed and support hasn't been provided and behaviours have been hugely problematic and lives around them have been damaged. So Housing First can offer us something absolutely, but it swings, its success is entirely dependent on appropriate accommodation and appropriate support services. And at the moment, I do not think we are geared to deliver that. So we need to think about it before we do it.
Any more comments on that, Jan Williamson?
But at the moment, we're placing people in bed and breakfast without support in communities. So as an alternative for people with multiple complex needs who are churning through a temporary accommodation system that they can't get out of the end of, to get settled accommodation, we would advocate it as a viable alternative.
Okay, do you want to follow up on some of that, Mr. Whiteman?
Thank you very much, that's very useful. I think we'll explore that further. When we've been visiting, we've been talking obviously about the statutory services and how they interact with third sector services, such as, you know, some of you represent here. And it's clear that the third sector is providing very good services. Some of the funding is a little bit vulnerable to year-on-year budgeting. And some of the relationship seems to be good, but not formalised as it should be. And I've been certainly getting a sense that the whole system is a bit vulnerable to revenue in the future, etc. Now, is some of this due to the fact that, as Tony Cain was saying, the statutory basis of this is rather outdated, and therefore the third sector's come in to fill in some of the gaps? And is there any merit in formalising or certainly improving the statutory framework to take in the organisations such as your own who are providing these services on a more formal or a more statutory basis?
Jan Williamson.
I think there's a benefit to not being so, because I think a lot of the people that we support have a mistrust of statutory services because of their life experiences, and so they will perhaps more readily engage with third sector organisations. But it's true that there are challenges in the relationships between third sector organisations and the local authority because of the commissioning climate that we're in. And I mean, in Edinburgh, the housing department are doing their best to work and to develop positive relationships. It's really very dependent on the people that are in post, and they change, and the budgeting, it's short term, isn't it? It's, you might win have a contract that's going to last for 3 years, but you might not. They can't guarantee the level of income in that contract for the next 3 years. It could reduce year on year, and that's challenging. And so you can't forecast and plan as a third sector organisation for the long term easily.
Any other comments on that, Mr. Kennedy?
I think it must be possible with all the analytical tools that are available to work out what the ongoing need for example, support services for people who are vulnerably housed is going to be. And given that it would be possible to work out what that level of need is, it must also be possible to work out what level of funding it will require to service that need. And following on from that, it should be possible to commission people to service that need over a long term. If I look at my own team of people that I work with on a day-to-day basis, we've been doing homelessness prevention work in Edinburgh since 2009. So a lot of the team have been there for that amount of time. They've built up huge expertise in all sorts of different areas depending on the needs of clients over that period of time. Yet, I don't know that I'm funded beyond the end of June this year. So, you know, it could be that we're not funding, that team disperses, that expertise is lost, and we're back to square one building it up again when there's an emergency and people decide. So what I would say is that there needs to be a focus on establishing what the need is and looking at what can be done to fund that over a longer period of time. And that's the only way, really, that the sort of the people who have ongoing need are going to be supported to get the best outcomes. It's a bit stop-start at the moment. But I think going back to your earlier point about relationships and how the statutory services should work with the local authority, I think I would echo what Jan says. It's we have our own ethos, our own way of working. It's important that we maintain a certain distance because people do see us as services that advocate on their behalf rather than statutory or government backed services. It's important.
Anyone else want to add to that?
Yeah, from a local authority perspective, I would echo that. I think the voluntary sector has brought huge diversity, real power and strength, innovation, flexibility, and real quality to some of the responses around homelessness. And some of what it does simply couldn't be replicated in the public sector. And the obvious example of that is Women's Aid. I do not think you could replace Women's Aid and the work it does with a statutory service. It just wouldn't work in the same way. So we need to be better at procurement and offer up more certainty. We need to be measuring outcomes in a more sophisticated way so that we're not measuring the wrong thing. And longer term funding and longer term contracts would be enormously helpful. But I don't think you're suggesting absorbing the voluntary sector into the statutory sector. I don't know how you would cast legislation that requires a particular set of relationships without risking some of the innovation and flexibility and independence that the third sector brings. I think the third sector would benefit from being more certain about its role and its long-term funding, though.
Okay, any additions? Adam Lang?
I would support a lot of that. From our point of view, we operate services out of four community hubs in the main cities in Scotland: Glasgow, Edinburgh, Dundee and Aberdeen, as well as a number of bespoke housing support services in some areas across Scotland as well. In the last 6 to 10 years, the the funding mix, if you like, for those services has changed drastically for us, from a huge reduction in statutory funding for the services we deliver and the support we provide, to a much now a much more varied mix of grants, trusts, lottery funding, our own voluntary raised income going into support services where there isn't statutory funding available. And the consequence that has for us is that it makes, and this really just echoes the point made by others, because I'm sure we're not alone in this, I know we're not, it goes to year-on-year cycles. You don't have any confidence in retaining good staff or the relationships we've built up. And I think if you link that back to the other points that have been made today, particularly the increasing work that we're all doing with people with multiple and complex needs, those people need a sense of and a guarantee of sustained engagement with them. And we're not currently tendering or designing services that are commissioned in a way to allow organisations in the third sector and others to meaningfully provide that support. And it's a big challenge operationally we have as a charity just now.
Thank you. Mr. Whiteman, do you want to follow?
Yes, that's extremely useful. As Tony said, I'm not through that question advocating the absorption into the public sector of these services, but in asking a question about formalities here, I think it's a response to the fact that a lot of these services are sort of marketized now. You're talking about commissioning, etc., and yet you're talking about short-term timescales, and yet you are an integral part of prevention, and therefore it seems to me, for esteem, if nothing else, there should be greater parity, perhaps. So some kind of formalization of that role, probably embedded in statute as some kind of recognition of roles or whatever. But I've just sensed there's quite a bit of vulnerability out there, in a sense in which the people who depend on these services, obviously, they're the people we need to be thinking about, but the services that are being delivered by the third sector seem to be in a bit of a shuggly peg in too many instances.
I'm not sure if there's a question on that, but I do see nodding heads. I think Kenneth Gibson wanted to explore this further, if that's okay.
Yes, thanks. Yeah. I mean, we've just heard actually about how the third sector delivers innovation, flexibility and expertise. I also think it delivers compassion to the service users, and that was certainly came through very strongly when I was at the Simon community last week. But what was interesting, though, I found quite surprising, was that in Glasgow there are 70 organisations providing homeless services. And while there is a high level of expertise, for example, I asked the service users which were the best and worst organisations, and City Mission, Simon Community, for example, came top. And then, of course, there was, not that you can really call it a third sector in my view, the Belgrove at the bottom of the heap. There was some confusion from service users about who exactly does what, because there are so many organisations. Clearly, evidence earlier, there was a mention of gaps, also duplication. I'm just wondering if there's an argument for the consolidation of some of these services in order to provide a more effective delivery. Now, obviously, that might mean, obviously, third sector organisations working together, as I'm sure many of them do, much more closely in partnership. But again, earlier in the session, we heard about training needs in local authorities. So there must obviously be differences in each organisation in terms of the training it's provided. So I'm just wondering if you can touch on some of these issues.
John Williamson, yes.
I think so much of the funding that third sector organisations receive has to be directed to frontline service delivery. Not many funders are interested in funding two big percentages outside of that. And I think that's something that funders should consider, that there is value in investing in organisations outside of just frontline delivery so that they can provide more training and upskill their workforce. And I think there is absolutely an opportunity to share training across the sector, and there are good examples of how that happens already in Edinburgh anyway, but I think we need more funding for aspects of our service other than direct service delivery to support that.
Okay, anyone else want to add to that? Mr. Lang?
I think part of what you're maybe referencing, or my understanding anyway of some of what you're referencing, is some of these charities that you're talking, because I also sit in the policy committee for the SCVO, and a lot of charities in Scotland are very, very small. They set themselves up to respond to local need as they see it in their communities. And there probably is, in that regard, sometimes a lack of broader strategic awareness of other offerings in that area, or on occasions joined up working. But I would also say that charities are very good at working together. Quite often the funding that comes from statutory and indeed trusts, lotteries and others requires you to work in partnership with other organisations. So there is a good culture and a good mentality within the third sector. But I think some of what you may be referencing there is the reality that charities respond to need. And I think if there are 70 organisations in Glasgow alone responding to homelessness, that tells you something very serious about the local authority provision of support for homeless people. And I think the two don't always go hand in hand. Charities quite often set themselves up, especially smaller scale community-based charities or initiatives, and they respond to a need. And if the need's there, what does that say about how the local authority, in terms of the role of the public services delivered, is supporting the people that it should be supporting? So I think there's a, probably quite a number of interlinked points that feed into that.
Wondering if there's an argument for consolidation of some of these services. If you've got one organisation which may be small but maybe highly innovative actually in delivering for the people that's set up most to deliver for, your other organisations could perhaps benefit from that in terms of their sharing of expertise. But you know, each organisation has to have its own structure as well, its own management, etc. Obviously, if there was less of that, perhaps, and it maybe if an organisation, for example, was only based in Maryhill, but it spread out across the whole of the north of the city, for example, they might be able to deliver a better service. And while some organisations may focus on very specific groups, you know, duplication and gapping must surely be inevitable in such circumstances, even if it's geographic gaps, as opposed to, you know, there might be an overall service within the city, but it only happens in Drumchapel, or it only happens in Castle Milk or Pollock, or wherever it happens to be. So that's what I'm trying to get at, especially at a time when, you know, revenue funding is tight. I mean, I understand Glasgow's going to cut its revenue in homelessness from 24 to 20 million a year, which is a significant gap in reduction in 1 year. And I'm wondering whether or not this is a way in which organisations can continue to deliver the expertise they do deliver, but without more pain than it is likely to come its way anyway.
Yes, Mr. Kennedy.
We're currently operating in a model in Edinburgh at the moment where we deliver homelessness prevention services as lead partner within a consortium of agencies, and that consortium approach, I think, was initiated to try and address some of the issues you're raising there. We are lead partner in a consortium of five different agencies, all of whom were operating independently before we came together as a consortium. And the idea is that. There's a range of expertise in there that one organisation would have difficulty providing, but also that there's less confusion for people who are using services in terms of where these services are going to be reached, and for people who are commissioning and referring into services. My own personal experience is that has worked very, very well. Previous to that system being set up, all of the organisations that are now working under that model were being funded independently to do the same sort of work. And I always felt, in a way, we were almost in competition with one another. Whereas I feel it's October 2014 we started that, and it's taken a bit of time, but I feel we're at a point where we work very well together and complement one another. And I mean, really how it works is a lead partner takes responsibility for the budget and distributing that between everyone, and coordinates how the work takes place and what expertise is best deployed in each situation. And yeah, I feel it works well, but that is a way of addressing some of those issues.
Help in terms of issues like budget, because if one organisation perhaps isn't so successful but they have good quality staff, it means that staff member is not lost, so to speak, to the service, if you like, because they can perhaps move on to work within one of the others in the consortium. Does it work in that regard?
Well, where I would say it works very, very well is that not every organisation needs to be administratively very strong. It's only really the lead partner that requires the administrative backup to organise. Not, we don't need, you know, five finance departments, five HROs, kind of whatever it is, kind of thing within the service, because like we have an organisation as lead partner have taken on the finance function for that whole consortium in terms of distributing that budget and those sorts of things. So yeah, there probably is a reduction in duplication of work there, but I think the key to it is, for example, of the five organisations that work with us, there's one that specialises in people with substance misuse issues. There's two that specialise in people with mental health issues. There's ourselves who have worked in homelessness prevention, welfare rights, those sorts of issues. So we can when people are referred to us, we can assess what kind of support they're likely to need, and in theory get them to the organisation that can best provide that support, rather than previously we would have been in a situation where, as if someone came to our door, we were going to take them because there was funding attached to that person. If you see what I mean, rather than send them to the guy down the road who was probably better placed to support them.
But each organisation still retains its identity.
Of course it does, yes.
Can I just ask one further question, and it's to Tony Cain specifically. It's just, Tony mentioned earlier on the huge issue of offenders going out into the community, and he talked about flexibility in terms of local connection points. How though would that flexibility work? Because I'm an MSP in North Ayrshire, but I was a councillor, MSP in Glasgow for 11 years, and I'm just wondering how that would be delivered without the situation whereby a huge proportion of former offenders, for example, decide to move to Glasgow, Edinburgh, and the other cities. You know, how would you enable that flexibility to work, but at the same time not have a huge increase, for example, in the number of people who might go to one area or another?
I mean, to be clear, I wasn't suggesting that the local authority that hosts a particular prison should then expect to house and accommodate and deliver services to everybody that's discharged from that prison. What I was more pointing to is the fact that it's very difficult for local authorities who are likely to have residents in all 15 of Scotland's prisons to ensure that any one of their residents at the point of release, the point of liberation, gets the support and service they need. So there's a conversation that needs to take place across the 32 authorities to ensure that in every prison there is a service, and that service is properly connected to the home local authority or the area that individual wants to move to. There are some issues in here about offenders, like everybody else, having a right to choose where it is that they want to go and live, and there are some occasions when offenders might not want to return to the home community. But I wasn't suggesting it's all about them moving out and being housed by the local authority. It's about local authorities working together and with the prison service and others to make sure that they are, that the point of their liberation is properly connected back to the homelessness service that they, or the housing service that they'll then approach. Can I just to respond to some of your earlier points, if I may? You and you'll forgive me. You said something about the level of compassion that you see in the services being delivered in the voluntary sector, and I absolutely wouldn't for 1 second suggest that's not the case. I would say that you will see very similar levels of compassion and commitment in many of the people working in local government who long term work with the same client groups and commit very strongly to doing their very best to deliver the sorts of outcomes that are there. So it's a feature of everybody involved in this system, to be honest with you. Just then dealing with some of the other bits and pieces, I do not think it is for a local authority to look at the range of charities operating in its area and start telling them to merge or do this and do that. But I do think a local authority can use its commissioning framework, and I appreciate the language can be uncomfortable, but the procurement framework, to direct and assist and support the provider framework in a particular way. But also, there are in most local authorities homelessness partnerships operating where the council will sit down with third sector organisations and talk about the way services are being developed, the direction and the needs and the gaps, and encourage and discuss with those organisations how they work together. And the sector itself has a huge track record in innovation, and you see that already in the way they are responding, developing joint working arrangements to better support the client groups they're dealing with. So I diversity in provision is hardwired into our housing system. There are 68 housing providers in Glasgow, never mind 70 organisations supporting social housing providers, 70 organisations supporting homeless people. So it's part of the geography of the world that we work in. I think that's probably a strength more than anything else.
Okay, Mr. Gibson, I'm going to take it in keen to move on. Do you want to explain further?
I think Tony did highlight the need. The fact that people in working local authorities do have compassion, I think you have to have compassion. They work in the sector. I think that's more or less taken as read. And I think the selflessness of people working in the sector is something that was very much highlighted to members of the committee on our visits.
And we're almost finished in this section. I just want to give a heads up to the committee members, actually. I think there's a line of question we probably have to explore in temporary accommodation that we haven't done yet. So catch my eye if you want to ask those questions, or else you'll just have to listen to me ask those questions. So do catch my eye. Adam Lang, I'm going to let you in a second to finish exploring this, but just can you pick up this other bit as well from Mr. Gibson's line of questioning? In Glasgow, we heard there was talk about third sector organisations bidding to be part of a consortium to then look at some form of service redesign or service development within the city. It wasn't clear whether that was going to be a procurement or tendering process, and I hate to kind of use all the various buzzwords, but I remember in with the prison service, talking of a public service partnership was spoken about, and we always hear about the idea of co-production and mapping out current service providers and in difficult financial situations, saying to current good quality service providers, here's the money we have, take that away. What would you design a service to look like that provides the best outcomes, and speak to the third sector seriously about that? Is that something that should be going on through the integrated joint boards? I know it's statutory duty is just older people services, but is there a more systematic view we'd be taking across Scotland via third sector interfaces, the voluntary sector, integrated joint boards, and what's happening on the ground? I'm not trying to open up a new line of questioning. I suppose what I'm trying to do is following on from Mr. Gibson, see if this is something we should explore further when we move into a formal call for evidence. So, Mr. Lang, I'm going to take you in. If you can let that wither on the vine, that comment I make, if you wish, or you can comment on it. But I know you did want in this particular section.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to follow up on part of what Tony had addressed in relation to Mr. Gibson's questions. There isn't currently any universal provision of housing advice for prisoners in Scotland, which is a problem. There have been services in the past which we have done and others have done which have worked in some prisons. There is an abundance of evidence to say that helps tackle these problems in a cost-effective and meaningful way. And it's a challenge we have right now that there is no provision of advice, housing advice for prisoners. Because, as I was saying earlier, the geography of our prison network, the 15 prisons, does not neatly align or match with our local authority and other public services. So that's something that I hope the new can be looked at, and I hope that the new community justice body, when it comes online, will also be taking a real focus on. In answer, convener, to your question there, I would say that I think the third sector generally has mixed experiences of how seriously it can be taken at times in some of those joint boards or community planning partnership or the various vehicles that are established in theory to hear from a range of voices, because the challenge, I think, comes down to and this is not perhaps speaking from solely from Shelter Scotland's experience, but more generally about the third sector. It's when the crunch comes on the funding that the provision of support focuses down on what's the statutory thing, what's the essential thing that we have to do, and how quickly do we have to do it. And I think it doesn't always run true that the various forums that in theory exist to give an equal share of voice. There's sometimes a sense of frustration that, I know that's true from youth work, from healthcare, for across the range of third sector, and again, planning, housing, the whole range.
Any other comments in relation to that before we move on, Mr. Cain?
Just pick up on the geography of service position around homelessness is now very, very complicated. In 1977, the Act was about what happens when you go to the housing department. Now you will find homelessness services within housing departments in some areas, within IJBs in others, within social care services in other areas. It's a very complicated setup. So the way in which you access that service isn't consistent or the same. And so understanding that can be quite a challenge. And I think it's also fair to say that the IJBs, even those that do carry, that are operating services around homelessness, haven't particularly been focusing on that area, and nor has most of the process around improving the engagement between housing and health and social care integration either. Much of the work of the IHUB around the improvement service around housing and health and social care integration has been about older people and, to a lesser extent, people with disabilities. And although we have been pushing for a conversation to start around services to homeless folk, we're not quite fully aware that there's a conversation, but we aren't there in terms of what's the focus of the work that IJBs are doing. How are they looking at their responsibilities around this particular group and starting to develop and improve services?
An opportunity for the third sector to be there would be a, look like rather than tendering for prescribed services.
There would be a place in there, undoubtedly. However, I think, given the way procurement rules work in the public sector, there will be very few opportunities for local authorities to fund third sector organisations without that being subject to a formal procurement process. That is what the law requires.
Okay. Any additional comments before we move on? Okay. Elaine Smith. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Convener. We want to move on, I think, to temporary accommodation, but there's temporary accommodation and there's temporary accommodation. And some of what we heard of in Glasgow was accommodation that was meant to be quite short term but ended up being longer term. I think the convener wants to explore some of that, but I really want to ask about rough sleepers. Having been a member of this parliament since 1999, I do know that the guarantee was given then of a target of ensuring no rough sleepers by 2003, and if I didn't know that, the shelter submission reminds us of that. But however, we now do seem to be seeing figures that suggest, or at least anecdotal evidence that suggests, that rough sleepers is actually increasing. So I have several, I don't want you to answer all of these because obviously we're looking to see what we would want to explore, but there seems to me to be several issues. First of all, it seems that it's churches, Christian charities, for example, in the big cities that are providing the overnight type accommodation, which is something I think Jan would know about. Secondly, we've done away with the big hostels, maybe in the hope that we would have stopped rough sleeping, but again, it seems that there might actually be a need. Maybe we're kidding ourselves on having taken away those large hostels where people can get overnight shelter if they're rough sleeping. So those would be my questions. Do we need to now look further at the situation of rough sleeping and what the solutions might be?
Okay, who would like to go for that? Adam Lang indicating it?
Thank you. I think it's really important to recognise that a couple of key points. There's no formal count on rough sleeping in Scotland, and I'm not necessarily saying that there should be one, but the numbers, I think everyone around this table would absolutely agree, and I hope from the experiences that you've all had, you would also agree that it is clearly rising, the level of rough sleeping in this country, and it is the most tragic form of homelessness. But I think it's very important to note that it is the tip of the iceberg on homelessness. It is the most visible form of it, but it is a symptom of a much bigger underlying problem beneath just rough sleeping. So I think it is important to look at rough sleeping and understand it, but there are more structural and systemic problems that lead to that. I would argue that part of that is because we have lost a bit of strategic focus on homelessness in the last, arguably really since the 2002 task force and the 2012 commitment, the joined up strategic focus with real cross-party leadership behind it has sort of dropped off the radar a bit, and we're now seeing rough sleeping rising, and it is linked to all the points that have been made earlier by everyone today, and it is very closely linked to the availability and supply of temporary accommodation. On the point about hostels, I would be very wary about advocating for a return to the use of hostels. I know there's been some initiatives floated about in recent months about essentially various modern models of hostel type accommodation. All the evidence shows that they come with significant challenges and risks for the individuals who would go there. But that said, I think it's an understandable question because we are seeing a rise in rough sleeping. But I think that we have to understand that the rise in rough sleeping is a system failure, and it's linked closely to the significant shortage of temporary accommodation and settled permanent accommodation.
Can I just come back slightly on that, though? And appreciate that, but it does then seem that the void is being filled by churches, for example, particularly in Edinburgh and Glasgow. It's churches. In my own area where I live, Coatbridge, you had an initiative where women were just wanting to open a church hall to deal with the problem. So there is a problem there. How we deal with it, I think, is something we might want to further explore. But we also heard when we visited legal services about, and I've had some experience of this, particularly with prisoners, people being released from prison, that to get temporary accommodation, so you're sleeping on the street, but to actually get some kind of roof over your head that you're due, you have to pretty much go and get a lawyer's letter and brandish it at the local authority. And even then, you may not be dealt with, and you've fallen back on this sort of 19th century charitable provision. And that can't be right either.
Mr. Keane. That is absolutely not right. So just to be absolutely clear, if somebody presents to a local authority and says, I have nowhere to sleep tonight, the statutory obligation is absolutely to secure accommodation is made available, and that is what should happen, although I acknowledge that it doesn't always happen. I don't think we should doubt for a moment that the process that shut the Great Eastern was the right process. These facilities were dangerous, they were difficult, they were inappropriate, they should not have been still in existence at the start of the 21st century. So there was no mistake made in the work that was done through the Homelessness Task Force, through the work the Rough Sleepers Work Early Doors around this Parliament to shut those institutions and provide alternatives. I think we don't. I think you're right, there has been a growth in rough sleeping, particularly in the cities. I don't think I see it. I don't stay in Edinburgh or Glasgow. I don't think I see it where I stay, but I definitely see it and have done for the last year or 18 months in Edinburgh and Glasgow. I don't think we necessarily understand why that has happened. I have two particular concerns, and again, these were picked up in the evidence I gave to the committee on the finance, on the budget. One is that some of these individuals are choosing to walk away from statutory services, so they have opted to sleep rough because it's actually better and safer for them, and they feel more in control than if they go to the council. And I think that's a very serious question that local authorities working with the third sector need to ask themselves, and I think there is a risk of that, and we need to be open to that. And the other one is, and I don't know to the extent to this is true, that some of the rough sleepers are economic migrants whose immigration status means they have no access to public funds. So it would be unlawful for a local authority to assist them, destitute though they are, because of the way the legislation works. I also know that some local authorities are housing individuals in those circumstances because officers simply refuse to put them out onto the street, not what they got into housing for in the first place. So my worry is that those two elements are a significant and very difficult to deal with part of what we're seeing in rough sleeping. But I would also say that I do not think we know enough about it, and we probably need to spend a bit of time looking at it in more detail. Rough sleeping is not the same as it was 15 years ago. Something has changed. It is on the rise. Some serious effort needs to go into responding to it.
Jan Williamson wants to come in. We might, only because we've got time constraints after this, we might have to move on just briefly to some questions on temporary accommodation, and then we'll need to close the session. But as I say, we will be returning to this. So, Jan, do you have something to add in relation to that?
We would agree that we see rough sleeping rising in Edinburgh, and that the reasons for that, it isn't just down to one reason. There are people who migrate here who don't have recourse to support from the local authority. There are a lot of people who feel unsafe in temporary accommodation and just don't want to be in there. And it's a sad state of affairs that sleeping on a church hall floor overnight with another 40 people is a better option. And then there are people who can't get into temporary accommodation because, certainly within Edinburgh, we experience often that if somebody doesn't have benefits in place, they won't get put into temporary or emergency accommodation. And that shouldn't be the case. They should get in while an assessment's undertaken, and then the issue of intentionality and local connection as well.
Okay, that's very helpful. Also leads us on. Is it late? I might break my rule. Lee, did you want to come in and add to that?
No.
Right.
No.
Okay. Excellent. Right. Brings nicely on to temporary accommodation. With a number of questions on that. I think Jan, you've put on the record about issues in some parts of the country in relation to having to have all your benefits in place before you qualify for the temporary accommodations. So that's sitting there, might, as part of our inquiry, ask more about that. I suppose the bulk of my constituency casework in relation to homelessness are families that may not have multiple and complex needs, who are just in small temporary accommodation flats, quite often tenement flats in my constituency, two bedrooms, four children, very, very cramped conditions and in properties that are in hard-to-let areas, looking for larger houses, and they seem trapped in temporary accommodation for quite a significant amount of time. Now, they do quite often eventually get out of it if there's a sensible use of housing allocations policy by social landlords who will partially meet their housing needs by offering a slightly larger property and return in the future to give them the ideal property for them. But too many families, in my experience, are trapped in very, very small, cramped accommodation for quite a long period of time. Now, that's anecdotal. That's maybe specific to the type of constituents that I represent in Maryhill and Springburn. But I suppose the question I'm asking is, across the country, what are the types of people? Is it individuals? Is it families? In terms of those that are staying in temporary accommodation, perhaps for too long, what are the barriers to permanent accommodation? And what types of questions, if you were our committee, would you be asking when we did the call for evidence? So hopefully that contextualises the type of questions we're wanting to ask in temporary accommodation. Adam Lang.
So in January of this year, Shelter of Scotland published the third annual report that we've now done based on FOI requests to all local authorities, trying to analyse and understand the time spent in temporary accommodation and to seek to answer exactly some of those questions. So to share a couple of the key findings, the average time a household spent in temporary accommodation last year was 24 weeks. The average time that a household with children spent in temporary accommodation has increased for the last 2 years and now stands at 20.2 weeks. The number of people in temporary accommodation is just over 10,500, and the number of children in temporary accommodation in Scotland is over 5,700, and that has gone up. And in the last three consecutive snapshot figures that are done on temporary accommodation in Scotland, the number of children in temporary accommodation has gone up. Last year in Scotland and the year before, children spent over 1 million days in temporary accommodation in Scotland, cumulatively in total. So that's some of the top level numbers around temporary accommodation as we understand it at this point in time. At the heart of that issue is the lack of supply of the chronic generational, if you like, lack of affordable housing supply, and crucially housing supply that is made available for social rent, so that local authorities, just echoing what I think has been said by all of us today, the local authorities have options in terms of what they can offer people, because you're absolutely right, convener. The assumptions made about what's needed don't always match. A lot of our casework is trying to get families who maybe have two children, three children. There's a general lack of supply of temp and social accommodation. There's a real huge lack of supply for family homes in some areas. And I think what that leads to sometimes is the challenges we have with the mixed implementation of some of this work, and some local authorities doing slightly better than others in terms of supply and in terms of service delivery. And there are some of the, you mentioned Glasgow, we know is quite challenging in some areas, but it's not alone. There are other local authority areas in Scotland where it's a real challenge.
Any other witness want to add in relation to, I mean, take this as the opportunity to put on record anything you would like to say in relation to temporary accommodation, because we're going to have to close the evidence session soon. So anyone want to comment? Jan Williamson?
I think you should extend the laws about unsuitable temporary accommodation to cover everybody, because anybody staying in unsuitable temporary accommodation for an extended period of time isn't acceptable.
Thank you. Any other witnesses want to comment? Mark Kennedy?
I'd just like to say that in our experience, where people are in temporary accommodation, unsuitable or otherwise, it's very disruptive, particularly for families. It creates real disruption in people's lives. They can't move on. They can't get jobs. They can't decide what schools their children are going to. There are all sorts of issues around that. But what we've found is, for a lot of people, the key to moving them into more permanent accommodation is there being support available to help them do that. The actual housing allocation system and housing option system in most cities in Scotland is quite Byzantine, and you actually need someone with a little bit of expertise of the system to help negotiate your way through that pathway. And a key to minimising the amount of time people spend in temporary accommodation will be ensuring they have help to get out of it.
Okay. See, just before, Tony Kane, I'll take you in. Just before you answer this, Tony Kane, I was just thinking, again, I'm talking about MSP, some of my constituency casework, where some of the social landlords now operate a choice-based letting system where they'll accept their obligation to house, but what they'll actually do is they'll have a group of allocations which are for homeless, and I've got constituents who will just keep bidding in and bidding in and not actually getting secure accommodation, whereas the old traditional route, with all its faults of a Section 5 referral, a housing association or local authority would accept that obligation on the basis they knew they had to house you suitably within a set amount of time. So just in terms of, I mean, apologies that I'm bringing this in fairly late in the day, Mr. Kane, it just popped into my head and I thought it would be remiss of me not to mention that when we're talking about those that are homeless and in temporary accommodation. So it's Mr. Kane.
And difficult to respond across the range of those things. Allocate in a world of shortage, we ration social housing. It's as simple as that. Allocations policies, whether they're choice-based or not, are rationing systems. And one of the biggest difficulties with a rationing system is demonstrating that it is fair and transparent, and that isn't easy. And there are a whole range of people that have a claim on social housing, and they all want to be treated fairly. They want to be seen to be treated fairly. And this is a binary set of outcomes. It's one or zero. If you come second, you don't get a house. And coming second doesn't mean you come first next time. You might come second forever. So this is a very, very contested area. It's driven by shortage, and part of the answer is ending that shortage. So, you know, there's the advert for the final point of my evidence, which says, rather than committing to a particular number of social rented houses over a period, we need to commit to grow the proportion of the stock in social renting, and particularly in those areas under the highest pressure, Edinburgh, Glasgow, bits of Fife, Mid Lothian, East Lothian, Perth, Aberdeen. These are the areas that need most of that investment. So dealing with shortage is a critical issue. I think in terms of the rest of the issues around temporary accommodation, length of stays have risen. The percentage of lets being made to homeless households has fallen over the last 3 years, and that's both by local authorities and by housing associations, but there is a gulf between the two. So local authorities are doing 38 to 40% of their lets. Some are doing significantly more on average. Housing associations are doing around 22 or 24% of their lets. Some are doing significantly more, some are doing none. So there are issues about the way in which the access system works. I think there's issues about integrating the homelessness route into mainstream access so that folk don't have to go into temporary accommodation at all. And there are many folk who present to local authorities who could just be given a house, and finding a better way of managing the access arrangement so that is what happens, I think is one of the tasks that we need to take on.
Okay. Any final comments from witnesses before we close this evidence session, Mr. Lang?
Thank you, Convener. To put on record, there's no government guidance on standards and temporary accommodation across the board, and we have campaigned and argued for a very long time that there should be and there needs to be, and I'd like that to go on record from ourselves. And the other issue, which is addressed both in Shelter Scotland's submission and Alacho's submission, is the looming crisis of funding for temporary accommodation, which I think is very important that it goes on record. There's a massive shortfall projected in how we fund temporary accommodation in Scotland to the tune of somewhere between £40 and £60 million annually. We need to start addressing that right now, otherwise that is just going to be an enormous problem. Temporary accommodation is the bedrock of our homelessness support system and our housing safety net in Scotland, and we know there's a huge shortfall coming and we need to do something about it.
Our witnesses will have a chance for a final comment, but Alexander Stewart wants to just sneak in a little comment first.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to, we've talked a lot about temporary accommodation, and rightly so, but in the rural aspect of Scotland, it is a major crisis. You know, we understand that in the cities that the problems are continuing to rise, but in the rural locations across Scotland, it is absolutely vital. And what you end up having is that people leave that location and may end up moving towards the city because there is nothing in between. So you're right to identify that we have the problem. But as I say, I really want to hear about what could we try and do in the rural aspect, because the funding within that and the whole process of trying to manage and keep people in that community is vitally important. And if we don't do that, then we're going to continually see a migration into the centre.
Only because, I mean, it's my fault we haven't closed the evidence session yet, Mr. Stewart, because I threw in an extra question as well. Time constraints means you may have to write to us if you've got anything specific you want to say on that. If you want to say just now, that's great, but I did give the promise of
final comment from each of our witnesses before we close the evidence session. So, Mr. Cain, can we start with yourself?
I would actually just echo that point. I think it's important to understand that homelessness is not the same in East Ayrshire as it is in Glasgow, as it is in Moray, as it is in Angus, as it is in Highland, and it requires a bespoke and locally designed response. But at the core of it, it's about access to housing, it's about choice, and our legislation is too narrowly cast to support a housing system that is delivering control over people's housing outcomes that would make a difference.
Okay, thank you. Lee Clark, do you want to any finish? You don't have to have any final comments, but opportunity.
For me, a key point is making sure that there's consistency in the approaches that the local authorities take.
Okay, Mark Kennedy?
We've covered everything.
Okay, Jan?
I think we'd welcome further investigation into rough sleeping and understanding the issues, the reasons behind that, and also exploring services for people with multiple complex needs.
Really helpful. And just before we close the session, Mr. Lang, anything to add?
I would just echo our call. We need action and leadership on homelessness now, otherwise we are going to see the numbers that have been declining for a while. They are going to go back up. These challenges are here. We need to act now on taking strategic approach, a whole system approach to supporting those people at risk of homelessness.
Okay. Can I thank all of our witnesses? What I think has been an excellent evidence session and will really inform our inquiry. We're determined that when we do our inquiry fully and do our call for evidence, that we are well cited in the questions that we have to ask. There's no point in starting an inquiry and asking the wrong questions. This has been incredibly helpful. So thank all of our witnesses, and we now move into private session. Thank you.